I've always been a huge fan of real-time strategy games. When I was a kid, I'd come home from school, wait while my family's Windows 98 PC booted up for half an hour while watching the latest Arthur episode, then I'd spend hours playing Forestry Simulator, which was released under the more commercially successful title of Age of Empires 2. It's also where I first got into the customization elements that would bring me into the modding scene, spending almost as much time creating maps full of trees for my villagers to perfect their forestry on as actually playing the game. Weirdly though, for the last decade they haven't really been very popular, with very few AAA games in the genre, and a general sense of disappointment in the RTS fanbase. Today I want to take a bit of a look at what the cause for that might have been, and more importantly, take a look at some of the signs that we might be coming out of these dark times. While the genre stretches back to the 80s, and technically late 70s depending on what you're including, the core titles which have come to define the genre for a lot of people started coming out in the mid-90s. We've already mentioned Age of Empires, the first iteration of which debuted in 1997, but Warcraft and Command & Conquer were also released in 1994 and 1995 respectively, all of which defined certain features or styles which would become fundamentally identifiable with the genre. 1998 saw the release of StarCraft, following up Blizzard's prior success with Warcraft 2, leading to its initial dismissal as Warcraft in Space, which, I don't know, still sounds pretty cool for me, but it did prompt some major rebuilds before the actual release of the game, leading to a very different game than what people got with Warcraft. These games played a considerable part in proving the genre had mainstream appeal, and would see follow-ups either within the same direct franchise, like Command & Conquer, or even some spin-offs or reskins like Star Wars Galactic Battlegrounds and Age of Mythology from the Age of Empires series. Other games like Total Annihilation and Homeworld continue to innovate, with Homeworld Space Combat introducing us all to a concept called Up. The period from 1999 to about 2008 was basically the golden age for RTS games. Whatever element of real-time strategy games you liked, there was probably a game that was released in this period that had what you wanted in spades. While some older games like StarCraft still managed to hold on to a lot of people's attention. Want your spaceships? You have Homeworld. Want weird live-action cutscenes from office employees that still stick with you until you find the sweet embrace of death? Command & Conquer's your game. Like any successful genre, we even got some nice tie-ins. The release of the Lord of the Rings movie trilogy gave us War of the Ring and Battle for Middle-earth, and over the course of the Star Wars prequels, we got Force Commander, Galactic Battlegrounds, and then finally in 2006 we got Empire at War, which brought together some of the features that people had liked about the earlier strategy games that I just mentioned here, as well as some features from Star Wars Rebellion, an older Galactic Conquest simulator. 2007 and 2008 saw the tail end of this golden age though. If it was opened by Age of Empires, Warcraft, StarCraft, and Command & Conquer, other great games like Company of Heroes, World in Conflict, and Supreme Commander made the bookend on the other side. Command & Conquer was still receiving new installments in 2007 and 2010, but they were not especially well received, particularly Command & Conquer 4. By this point, the franchise was not even being made by its original developers. Westwood Studios, which had made not just the original Command & Conquer games, but also Dune in 1992, another important RTS game, had been acquired by Electronic Arts and then closed after Command & Conquer Renegades, a third-person shooter, and another game called Earth and Beyond had failed to perform as well as EA had hoped. Many of those pushed out of Westwood by this went to found a company called Petroglyph, the developers of Star Wars Empire at War. But this still meant the company that had once been one of the biggest names in the RTS genre alongside Blizzard now had fewer resources than they may have under Electronic Arts or the prior owner of Westwood, Virgin Interactive. After 2010, it wasn't that nobody tried to make new RTS games, but there were a few factors which kind of pushed them to the side. There are a few crucial titles I've left out of the discussion so far, and they're actually related to why, in my opinion, the genre fell off as much as it did when it did. This isn't to say there wasn't any room for RTS games in this time. Some even received remakes or multiple remakes in that period, like Age of Empires, and maintained a pretty healthy competitive scene or fan base on YouTube and streaming sites up until the present day. This period also saw arguably the highest profile RTS game of all time, StarCraft II, get released, though it's still been over 10 years since even that, and not to say that StarCraft II isn't a good game, but part of why it sticks out as much as it does in my opinion is that there wasn't really much being released around or after it in the RTS genre. Petroglyph has been making strategy games since Empire at War, but despite essentially carrying the mantle of the Command & Conquer devs forward, they haven't received much attention. Even their titles following pretty quickly after Empire at War, including Universe at War and Grey Goo, didn't receive quite as much attention as some of the earlier titles did. There are other games like Ashes of the Singularity by Stardock, Deserts of Karak, Northgard, and even many indie titles which have been really good that just haven't received quite as much attention as they had earlier, despite a vocal group of people demanding more RTS games, and there's definitely an appetite for them. This is where we get to some of the other points that I personally think factor a lot into this, beyond just what the publishers may think will work or not. There are some elements like how changes in graphics and tech may have been less beneficial for the readability in RTS games and made them a bit harder for people to get into than they might have been earlier, which definitely had an impact on how RTS games played beyond just how they looked. But two main points I want to focus on are somewhat interrelated, being the rise of other genres and the growing prominence of free-to-play multiplayer games. I haven't mentioned games like Total War, Paradox's grand strategy games, or even Sins of a Solar Empire so far, because while games like those fit the RTS genre or have many elements of it, they're different in a key way that actually stayed possibly more niche, but still popular over the years. Empire management games or grand strategy games that focus less on the combat or have the combat more contextualized, so it's part of a broader game of controlling the world like in Total War, have remained very popular over this period. Civilization, for example, is still one of the most popular franchises on Steam, and the Paradox franchises, including Europa Universalis, Hearts of Iron, Stellaris, and Victoria, so on, have become pretty popular as well. They're technically real-time strategy games, but their focus is very different from the traditional unit control or base-building elements that are not universal, but typical of the kinds of RTS games that have been lacking recently. While Total War has the heavy use of tactical elements, as does Sins of a Solar Empire, the campaign maps are a very important part of that, which is turn-based in Total War and real-time in Sins. Ultimately, the RTS genre seems to have split somewhat in two. Half the focus on the broader scope side went to those kinds of empire management games, while the other half went largely to the burgeoning MOBA genre, or multiplayer online battle arena, which was born itself out of Dota, a mod for Warcraft 3. There have been some other popular games that fill a similar strategy niche but have tended to adopt the more city builder element to themselves, like with Anno and Tropico, where there is RTS elements, but it's still more of a civ builder or city builder. Games have largely seemed over the last 10 years to be in a trend of having one or two games that people really stick with for long periods of time, with live service models being a pretty huge part of that. MOBAs in particular fit that model to a T, while I think strategy games that have longer form narrative elements tend to have a bit more staying power with people, especially with how readily they translate to platforms like YouTube or Twitch for a Let's Play or stream series. They inherently provide context. So where MOBAs tend to scratch the more competitive itch of the micromanaging RTS genre, grand strategy games have tended to still satisfy the megalomaniac and control freak in all of us instead. Recently though, there's been some signs that this could be changing, and there could be a bigger appetite not just for RTS games from fans, but also from bigger publishers, something that's been crucially lacking in the last few years. This comes primarily in the form of resurrecting many of the franchises from that golden age I was talking about. Age of Empires 4 is set to come out pretty soon, making the first new installment in the series since 2005, meaning not a remake or expansion for Age of Empires 2, though I'd probably gladly buy yet another of those. EA even partnered with Petroglyph to do a remaster of the original Command & Conquer, which could lead to opportunities for future work in that direction. We've also got Homeworld 3 and Company of Heroes 3 slated for release at some point in 2022. Some of these games, especially Company of Heroes 3, seem to have adapted some of the grand strategy genre features for themselves, which seems like it's probably going to be more of a common thing as we go forward, but the core of what made Company of Heroes Company of Heroes does still seem to be there. Obviously, that's a lot of games with numbers at the end of their names, but who knows what else is in development that we haven't heard of yet, or if those games are successful, what we might get beyond that. The important thing, in my opinion, is that it shows major publishers think there's enough of a there to be worth investing in AAA RTS games again, and I think other trends have shown that to be the case as well. Live service games and the grand strategy and MOBA genres aren't going anywhere, and I love both actually, so I wouldn't want them to, But recently we've seen a lot more games that don't have to have the massive amounts of buy-in from a huge player base for a long period of time to survive or be seen as viable to do in the first place. EA famously said single-player games just aren't what people wanted, and while they were rightfully memed to death for that, I think it did reflect something of a real trend in what people were playing, and certainly what companies were willing to make. Part of that based on player trends, but part of that also based on production costs and payout, without getting too far into which direction the causal relationship there went. I don't think games like Star Wars Fallen Order, for example, were as likely to be made as they were a few years earlier, or that they frankly could have done as well as they did, but that seems to be changing now. During the entirety of this downtime in AAA RTS games or AA RTS games, there have been a lot of indie RTS games that have come out, taking some of the simpler premises of more classic RTS games and building upon those. But I think we're seeing signs now that publishers are willing to put a bit more money behind some of these projects. Ultimately, a lot of it will come down to what people are willing to support, so hopefully if these titles do well, we'll have more strategy games for years to come. That's gonna do it for today though. Which upcoming RTS game are you most looking forward to? Or is there one that we haven't heard of yet which you hope gets announced someday? Let me know in the comments. Thanks for watching, and I hope to see you next time.